return to Wednesday's proceedings examining the Waco investigation. Last week, a House Joint Subcommittee began hearings into events at Waco, Texas in the spring of 1993.
No, he was next door. This one. Yeah.
Right, John, I'm going to go ahead. We can have the witnesses back at the table.
The subcommittee will come to order. When we were recessed, it was a time for the Republican side of the aisle, but the Democrats have gotten back here sooner, and Mr. Conyers is sitting there with his time, and I'm going to give you your 5 minutes now, Mr. Conyers.
I'd like to talk with Mr. Kavanaugh. He's on the way.
Clock would turn it off to you. So Mr. Kavanaugh gets seated and everybody's ready to go.
Did you notice I didn't even make any requests for additional time because I knew the chairman's fairness would cover us?
I appreciate that, Mr. Conyers. All right, I think we got Mr. Kavanaugh in seat, and Mr. McCarthy still hasn't entered the room, but you don't need him right now for your question. Is that right?
I'd like to begin my discussions with Mr. Kavanaugh.
Farewell. Please proceed. You're recognized.
Sir, you were in a unique role in this episode that's being relived many, many times here in the hearing room. You were both a commander and a negotiator. And as such, you played a key role in each capacity, and I congratulate you for your very important performances in both areas. One thing that's been said in terms of negotiation is that, of course, we were dealing with people with a religion that was unique and not popularly understood. And it's been gone over time and time again. We have to understand from their point of view and so forth. Was that something difficult for you or the other negotiators to understand? In other words, it seems to me a little simplistic for us to say, well, you've got to take into consideration that these were Davidians and they believed in other things. How could one not do that? I mean, what else would you be thinking of? These are not hard-shell Baptists. These are not Catholic. These are not any. They're who they are. And to what degree, Mr. Kavanaugh, was that understood by yourself and others that participated in the negotiation process with you?
Congressman, I fully respected their religious beliefs, whatever degree there was there of religious beliefs, and all, I think all the other negotiators did also. I don't mean to be sarcastic, but my feeling was they can worship a golden chicken if they want to, but they can't have submachine guns and hand grenades and shoot federal agents. I played the role as a policeman. That's what I am. I didn't try to fool the Davidians that I was something else. And I think that's one reason that Koresh certainly trusted me from the beginning. I didn't try to fool Koresh or trick him. I simply said, look, I'm a policeman. We want to resolve this situation. Our shared problem is this conflict. Let's see if we can work it out. And I think every negotiator that followed me took the same track. Normal strategy in a negotiation. And like I say, Congressman, I was I'm a rookie at this, and the experts are on my left. But I think any policeman, any special agent, respects the sanctity of life. And I certainly respected the sanctity of Mr. Koresh's life. It was difficult for me because I had watched him kill 4 agents and shoot 20 others. That made it difficult for me.
Well, I want to tell you that our staff studies that I've gone over recognize that you treated your negotiating role with patience and good listening skills, and that your training as a negotiator held you in good stead. Now let me turn to your other role as a a law enforcement commander, in which you were trying, you spent a considerable amount of time into the hours of trying to rescue Special Agent King, who was caught in a crossfire, and there was apparently some difficulty in getting to him. Would you recapitulate that for us, Mr. Kavanaugh?
Yes, Congressman. I think it's important to know, because some of the facts that have come out in the other areas may be cleared up here. If you look at that chart, the roof of the chapel is on the right side, the center line up and down. And that's the window just on the right where everybody's watched on TV the three agents go in. Kenny King went over the peak of that roof to the window on the left.
Could you show us where it is? I'm not sure if I'm following.
The ladder's here.
Yes.
Kenny King and Todd McKeon went to this window. Conway the Blue was on this ladder. A lot of the rounds that fired through the roof of the Davidian Dome place were fired from this tower, down at Agent King and McKeon, Conway the Blue. Certainly there's rounds from the tower through this roof that we heard attorneys discuss, rounds down through the roof. And there was rounds up through the chapel roof because they heard the agents up here. And Bill Buford, who testified, was wounded inside this room from rounds being shot up. Those rounds that missed him would have come out this room. And the agents on the ground here would have been shooting up this way through this room. So I just want to mention that. But Kenny King fell off here. He fell in this alcove. We had no men. This was the first extent of our teams right here.
Mm-hmm. Now, you were trying to reach King, who was indicating that he was seriously injured.
Yes, sir.
And were you trying to get the Davidians to hold their fire, or what were you doing during that time, and how was King ultimately rescued?
One thing, Congressman, was we couldn't reach a ceasefire agreement. And the only thing I would impart that's not shown on the videotapes, on the television shows, is that this wasn't a gun battle where a few men were on the roof and a few were shot. This was a gun battle where thousands and thousands and thousands and thousands of rounds were fired. That's the way it was. The shooting, I remember, didn't stop for 40 or 45 minutes, and then when it did stop, it continued sporadically. Small skirmishes would break out of a few hundred rounds. And during the negotiations to get a ceasefire, this same thing would frequently happen. The Davidians would fire on someone, and we'd respond, or they'd accuse us of firing, and so forth. So the ceasefire initially broke down three times. When we finally reached it, I radioed to Pete Maston, who was on the New Orleans side, and I asked him, I told the Davidians we're going to send four agents. They're going to get the wounded man in the back, and they're going to stand up. You know, you
that
can't shoot
King,
him. That was King. That was
King. And he was there, caught between this gunfire for what period of time?
Well, he was shot probably about 10 a.m., and he was there for at least 2 hours when this was going on. Got and he had been shot through the chest, through his bulletproof vest, with a submachine gun, and back out the other side. And I'd like to mention, if you'd let me, that all the men who were wounded there, and also women, we had six women there, too, and one got the Medal of Valor. But all the men who were wounded, we saved. The only agents who died were those who were killed immediately. And we were much criticized for a medical plan. And that's atrocious. We had medics, ATF-certified paramedics, who treated our wounded on the ground, who gave Bill Buford plasma. Yeah. When he was shot laying there. That's the only reason he's alive. I don't know that there's a law enforcement agency that gives plasma. I mean, we went in there trying to be prepared for the worst.
I commend you for the really outstanding services that you performed for your agency and for the men that and women that were with you that day. Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman.
Mr. Booyer, you're recognized for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. A couple real quick questions, and I've got a comment and a series of questions. One, and Mr. Jamar, and I was listening to Mr. Brewster's questions to you about some tapes and what they were played and what they consisted of. Would you please produce to this committee those tapes either this afternoon or tomorrow? Could you do that for this committee, please?
I'm uncertain of which tapes.
But there's some tapes about the kind of tapes that you were playing.
Are we talking about the rabbit?
The rabbit tapes and the.
I'm sorry. I don't believe we'll produce them. Yes.
Thank you very much. And the other question that I have is, who do you report to? Do you report to anyone in Washington?
You mean during the the crisis?
Yes.
The person I reported to was Larry Potts, who's Assistant Director of the Criminal Investigative Division at that time.
Okay. Thank you. The other thing that's been going through my mind here is several things. First of all, I want to commend all of you to your service to country. A lot of times, you know, the military always gets highlighted, and sometimes they forget about law enforcement who's on the lines day in and day out for the preservations of our securities and economic opportunities here at home. So let me thank you.
Thank you.
Likewise, gentlemen, you know, a lot of times there's been the analogy used quite often with the military-style operations and when we have our HRT, our hostage rescue teams, and they're trained in sort of the paramilitary-style tactics and CQB, close-quarter combat training. And, you know, in our military, you know, they're trained very well in the MOUT, the military operations in urban terrain. That's basically they're going to go in indiscriminate fields of fire, throw the grenade in and kill anything that moves. That only takes a couple of days of training. But CQB and laying down discriminate fields of fire with our highly perishable skills, and that takes many, many months of training. Agreed?
Yes, sir, I agree with that.
All right. So when I think about the military aspects of this, and I think some of the military advisors and are very, very cautioned, but you know what, I think about the military operations and when you have combat, people die. People are wounded. You do, in fact, have casualties. And a lot of the battles and the histories, I'm a military historian also, how awful it would be to bring in a company commander before a congressional hearing when there was loss of life because good men made bad decisions. In battle, good men make bad decisions quite often. But I want you to know that while I give the military analogy, part of the reasons and processes for this is that we are a lawful society. And in a lawful society, as bad as we now know Mr. Koresh, in fact, to be, the ends does not justify the means. That would lead to a lawless society. And we do have the constitutional rights of you're presumed innocent until proven guilty. And we all understand that, and you understand it, because you're on the line day in and day out to preserve the Constitution by your oath, no different than our oath. Let me ask a question. The thing that has concerned me, Mr. Sage, is some of your thought processes here. In your April 15th meeting, telephone conversation with Mr. Hubble, in reading the Justice report, it really indicates you were really getting frustrated here. I mean, that's my reading of this, is you were really very challenged at the moment, because Hubble recalls Sage saying he believed there was nothing more he or the negotiators could do to persuade Koresh to release anyone or to come out himself.
I still state that that's slightly overstated, but we had reached an impasse.
Okay. But see, that could be part of the problem. I think what I walked away from yesterday's hearing is that there was a tremendous disconnect, perhaps, between those of you who are the negotiators on the field and the political appointees in Washington. And if you're saying that's an overstatement, are you saying that the Assistant Attorney General Hubble may have overstated and then provided not factual information to the Attorney General that she used as a basis to make a decision?
I'm not speaking for Mr. Hubble. I'm speaking for my recollection of conversation with Mr. Hubble.
So you disagree with Mr.
At no
Hubble's
time did we abandon negotiations.
So then you disagree with Mr. Hubble's perceptions of the conversation that you had with him.
I have some concerns about the degree to which it's expressed in that report.
What about the fact that Hubble, you must have informed Mr. Hubble that law enforcement personnel at Waco were getting tired and that tempers were fraying.
I don't recall having said that. Our operations are not driven by fatigue or frustration. There's a level of professionalism here that is going to ensure that we give the best possible commitment to a particular set of circumstances.
I understand that, but you also agree that
if we're not able to perform to that level, then we'll replace the person that's there.
I understand that, but you've also, we are in agreement, there are highly perishable skills. And a part of those skills also can be, in fact, be negotiating skills. And when I say that is that, you know, as a negotiator, I'm not Monday morning quarterbacking you. Not only are you utilizing your expertise, your intelligence, data, but you're also dealing with stress and frustrations.
Certainly.
Trying to put myself in your shoes, I would have some sense of that. But part of my concern is here, if we have Mr. Hubble here on the 15th saying, these are my impressions of a two-hour conversation with you, and then he is having then a conversation with the Attorney General, because on the April 16th, we have the Attorney General basically disapproving the plan to end the standoff. So if on the 16th, they were disapproving the plan, there's a real problem here. All of a sudden, someone who, in fact, must have tried to convince the Attorney General that we have to go forward, and that this April 14th meeting, there are tremendous disconnects here. I know I've just run out of time, and I'll explore this later, and I'm sure I'll be able to talk with the Attorney General, and I'll be more than happy to talk to you.
I believe I'll be on that other panel, other participants, or at least people that were in the room during the course of that conversation in Waco.
Good. Then we'll carry this on further.
Yes, sir.
Thank you,
look
sir.
Forward
Thank
to
you.
It.
Mrs. Thurman, you are now recognized for 5 minutes.
There's been some conversation about this letter or something that was sent by Mr. Myron or Myron?
Murray Myron?
Yeah, and just to clear it up, there was one last, who is he, first of all?
He's a professor of psycholinguistics, I believe, at Syracuse University.
Was he involved with this?
Apparently so.
Okay. Anyway, just I think Mr. McCollum and one of the others had mentioned, I'm not sure who, had talked about this letter, that there might be an ability to work this out or that things had changed on this April 15th. However, the letter that I have says, in summary, I do not believe there is in these writings any better or at least certain hope for an earlier end to the siege. So I just kind of wanted to clear that up and know who this gentleman was. Yesterday I asked a question because we've, like you, have taken in a lot of information over the last couple of days. And I have to tell you, how you came to conclusions, I'm not sure, and I want to find that out. I've been trying to reconcile in my own mind based on the information. I mean, I've heard from Jewel, Sparks, Rodriguez. Then I heard last night from lawyers and theologists and each telling me different things. Some telling me that they were going to go through the prophecy. Some saying there was a possibility we could get out of this. In your training and through this operation, how did you reconcile all of these different people coming to you with all of these different concerns?
The analysis by negotiators who were talking to these people constantly, they had a good feel. They understood people. They were trained to do this, to get a feel for people. I think they were the most reliable among the people who were there, among our people, as to how reliable what the people were saying is, how much they could rely on what they were saying, how accurate the information was. We had a lot of people call us offering all sorts of information. But we had people decide after each shift what was significant, what happened this last, whatever the shift was, whatever it happened to be, what happened during this period compared to what we did before, and then analysis of maybe the previous 10 shifts or maybe the previous 3 days. What's happened? What happened to the recommendations we made, or what happened to the conclusions we made? Are they still good based on what's occurred? The analysis was constant because they were in constant conversation. These are people who were trained to do this, and it was a huge team. Byron coordinated one shift. Gary was overseeing the whole thing for several weeks. And they had 10 and 12 people working each shift, supporting each other. They had a primary person talking, but everyone else was absorbing what was going on and helping them and pushing them to ask questions or interpreting what was going on. And at the same time, another person was writing down highlights of what was going on. So all these people, to include behavioralists and everybody else, absorbing this. And it was constantly reassessed and reanalyzed over and over again.
Okay. I can respond to that. I mean, certainly. There was a great many people that called in. And how do you choose which theologian is the right one to turn to? We had one occasion where a gentleman in a cowboy hat and a late model Cadillac pulled up to the perimeter, and he offered to negotiate Koresh out, was certain he could do it. The troops thanked him for his assistance but said we could handle it. And as he drove off, his personalized tag said, God. And perhaps we should have turned to him as well. I don't know. But I think in terms of some of the armchair theologists who have criticized us, I think a good question would be, how many times have they talked to someone with a knife at someone's throat, a gun to someone's head, or someone up on a bridge about to jump? Because the negotiators on our teams have done this hundreds and hundreds of times. And while we listened to their advice and tried to take into account as many different suggestions as we could, ultimately we had to use the experience of some of the best negotiators in the United States who'd been assembled for this effort. And I always judge it on, what would I do if my children were inside that compound? And I'll tell you, the very last thing in the world I would do would have some untrained theologian try to talk to a religious fanatic to get my child out. I would hope that an FBI or a law enforcement negotiator with skill and training and experience, knowing how to talk to people in crisis, would be there to do it. And that's ultimately what we did, Congresswoman.
How long have you been doing this?
Negotiating for 15 years, in the FBI for almost 23.
Let me ask another question that I don't think has been brought out, because we kept hearing about promises kept, promises broken, and those. There was one last gentleman that came out of the compound, Mr. Fagan, I understand. Would you like to give us the story surrounding that and how you believe what happened under that? Because I think that plays a significant role in this, and we really have not talked about it.
I believe it does as well. I think Mr. Fagan came out with a mission. The last person to come out prior to him was on the 21st. In fact, seven people came out on the 21st. And it's at least my opinion that maybe not everyone shares, that perhaps Koresh was beginning to have some concerns about some people having second doubts and wanting to come out. And I believe he sent out Livingston Fagan with a very clear mission, and that was to thwart the flow of people out of the compound. You may have heard our whole strategy was trickle, flow, gush, trying to get as many people out as we could. Every person that had been released from the compound, by agreement with Koresh, would call into the compound to indicate that they had been picked up, well-received, and well-cared for. And that was a standard procedure. In almost every instance, in all instances, we initiated the call to follow through on that agreement. When Livingston Fagan came out, as soon as the tactical people literally put hands on him, he said, "You're mistreating me, you're beating me, I refuse to call back in." Then, for the first and only time, no sooner had he been taken from the scene than David Koresh calls in and says, "I demand to speak to Fagan." And he had never done this before. And of course, we had to report that Fagan, in fact, refused to talk to Koresh. We believe Koresh used that to convince other people inside that, look, the FBI is mistreating Fagan, they won't let us talk to him anymore, and attempted to use this as a rationale to stem the flow of people outside. And we feel the whole thing was a plant by Koresh.
Well, I had more questions, but my red light is on. But I want to tell you all, thank you very much for being here and sitting through this. And certainly having to go through this all again, I can tell it's taken a toll. Thank you.
Mr. Barr, you're recognized for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. We've been engaged over several days, as I think you all can tell, asking a series of what I think are very insightful questions and receiving a lot of information. Lest you leave from here with the impression that everybody on that side of the aisle is just can't say enough nice things about you and we're all the bad guys. Specifically, the gentleman from Michigan previously praised you, and I'm sure he was sincere in that. But just 2 years ago in testimony and when these hearings were held, he called what you did a disgrace. So there's more than meets the ear in these things. What we're trying to do, certainly over here, is ask some questions to avoid these problems coming up in the future, and I would certainly hope that you all would share in that. Mr. Kavanaugh, I have in my hand here a amount of Play-Doh. Mr. Bush, if you could This is just standard Play-Doh. If that were a flashbang grenade or a stun grenade, the same thing, which was live, which pin had been pulled, would you feel comfortable just holding that in your hand?
Well, Mr. Barr, a flashbang grenade ejects a cardboard tube out the bottom, so if you knew, you could probably have it hold it in a proper way to have it eject. A flashbang grenade, my answer is no. I would not want to hold it, but a flashbang
right.
grenade is no fragmentation at all.
No, I know that, and don't anticipate where I'm going with it. I don't mean for you to be defensive. There's no reason to. Earlier today, there was testimony from Mr. Schumer that these are not devices that can harm somebody, and in fact, they can, can't they?
Well, there is no fragmentation. There is concussion
right.
and a blast.
Is a flashbang the same as a stun grenade?
Stun grenade, yes, sir.
Okay. Those are classified as destructive devices under 26 U.S.C. Section 5845F, aren't they?
Yes, sir, they are.
And as a matter of fact, ATF in court takes a position in convicting people that possess these devices that they are destructive devices. Is that true?
Yes, sir, that's correct.
That they can kill people. Is that true?
Well, I think it would be you'd have to hold it close to your body, but it's possible, certainly, yes, sir.
Well, a gentleman by the name of Warren L. Parker, an explosives enforcement officer, Bureau of ATF, on May 11, 1994, in court, said under oath that they are designed to help kill the suspect while not endangering the law enforcement officer when they're used for those purposes. But anyway, again, I'm not being critical of you or anything. I think that there were some mischaracterizations deliberately this morning that I wanted to clear up with regard to these. The question that I have relates to what appear to be some very serious miscalculations on the part of law enforcement officials trying to gauge the response of the people inside the facility there. Both at the beginning of this, we had agents testify that despite the fact that the folks on the inside knew what was coming, they had amassed large numbers of weapons, which is obvious from looking at the questions and hearing y'all's testimony. The agents said they were stunned. They were surprised at what happened. And then on the other end of what we're talking about right now, going in with I guess what you all consider somewhat more benign activities, such as the introduction of the tear gas, some surprise on the part of the firing that came out of there and so forth. And the question, I have here an autopsy photo, and I'm not going to introduce it because it's rather gross. And it's very sad. It's a photograph of a one-year-old child, it's been burned. And right in the middle of the remains is a ferret round. Right smack in the middle of the remains of this one-year-old child is a ferret round with the CS gas. I find it hard to follow y'all's thinking if the activities on April 19th were considered to be benign. They caused a lot of deaths. We may never know exactly who died. A lot of the autopsies reveal that people died from suffocation and debris falling on them, and we may never know how much of that was caused from the walls caving in when the tanks came in and so forth, or how many others might have died from the ferret rounds coming in. Do y'all feel, and again, I don't mean to be critical, but I think there were some bad misgauging of responses on the other side. Do you all recognize that in hindsight, certainly, which is what we're all operating under here, that there were miscalculations with regard to how these folks in there would respond to what they, I think, correctly identified as aggressive moves? And I'm not saying the aggressive moves were necessarily unjustified. Is that of concern to you all as you kind of look back on this whole process? Mr. Jamar?
I think the inability to get people to come out of there with some gas was a surprise to us. The fact that the course was able to control those people such that they didn't get out, and the fact that they end up all dying in what I consider murder-suicide. I think there were 17 who were shot in there. When that was and how they were shot, I don't know. I think you're saying here's a ferret round lying in the remains of a one-year-old child, and then concluding that child died from that ferret round is, I think, contrary to the to the autopsy, I would think. But there's no question that we were concerned about a mass suicide. We were. But on the other hand, we were concerned that if there was a mass suicide, how could we stop it? And the only means we had was gas.
Knowing, and you all had accumulated a great deal of information on the Branch Davidians over the course of the 51 days.
I mean, correct.
A great deal of information, mm-hmm. both direct and conclusory information on them. Coming in as happened on the 19th with military vehicles, pushing cars out of the way and coming in and interjecting the CS gas directly into the building, and then as it progressed through, I think the report says, through every window in the building. And my question is, what response did you expect? Did you really expect them just to come out?
No, I expected the tear gas to drive some people out, but you overstated it. These military vehicles have been around here for 7 weeks. It's the view of the branch.
No, I know they were in the area, but they didn't come up and start knocking down the wall.
Close to the front door as you and I are. The cars and everything were removed the day before. There was no crashing through cars to get to the house. One tank approached the compound, just one. All the others were back. The Bradleys were behind the concertina wire. They were announced. We were not in it. The thing, the semantics he was talking about, the assault, hitting the building and punching hole in the building and injecting gas is assault in any legal term. But the difference to us, when Byron announced it was not an assault, he immediately filed that we are not entering the compound. It was not an entry. We were never going to enter the compound. We would never fulfill that aspect of the prophecy. But the fact we used the military is they had 50 caliber.
But weren't
we used
walls,
armor.
Weren't their walls knocked down?
No, not when they first approached. They just punched a hole in and injected the gas.
But thereafter.
After holes were made in the compound. I'm told, a witness and everything else, of the 9 survivors, 7 are either directly rescued by an HRT or came out of holes created by those tanks. That's what I'm told from the survivors.
Mr. Wise, you're recognized for 5 minutes.
Thank you. I'm going to yield some time, but I just want to note, gentlemen, I think you had an incredible task ahead of you. You're dealing with a child abuser. You're dealing with someone who's molesting children, who's knowingly stockpiling automatic weapons, who's not wrapped real tight by anyone's definition, and yet you're supposed to negotiate your way through that, and I think that's why I'm greatly concerned about some of the Monday morning quarterbacking that's going on the decisions that you had to make. I think you did the best you could in a terrible situation. At this point, I would yield 2 minutes to Mr. Schumer and 2 minutes to Ms. Jackson-Lee.
I thank the gentleman for yielding. Mr. Sage, I want to take my chance, my shot at clearing up this business of whether there was ever a real surrender agreement, as Mr. DeGuerin and Mr. Zimmerman claimed yesterday. So please answer the questions as concisely as possible. First, let me go through some of the major previous occasions on which Koresh built everybody up about coming out and then cut them down and ultimately showed himself to be a liar. First, March 2nd, this was the big day when Koresh promised that everybody was coming out if a tape he made was broadcast on the radio. The tape was in fact broadcast. All sorts of preparations were made for people lined up to come out. But David Koresh changed his mind and broke his word, did he not?
That's correct.
And the reason he gave was that God had instructed him to wait, did he not?
That's right.
Second, March 19th, Koresh said he was coming out in the next few days, did he not?
Yes.
But in fact, he never followed up on that promise, did he?
No, sir, he didn't.
March 31st, this was the Passover promise. Both of the attorneys who were here yesterday, DeGuerin and Zimmerman, said that Koresh had agreed to come out after Passover, did they not?
They said that, yes.
And did Koresh himself not confirm in a conversation on April 2nd he was coming out after Passover?
That's correct.
Then there was some confusion about exactly which date David recognized as Passover, but after all those possible dates passed again, he again broke his promise and did not come out, did he?
That's correct.
Okay, so there were just these 3 of the major highlights of times Koresh promised to come out and broke his promise. Now, turning to the testimony you heard yesterday, and specifically the claim that there was an agreement, a specific plan to surrender, not just some attorney's gratuitous proposal, but an agreement. Was there ever such an agreement known to you?
There was a hope embraced by the attorneys in good faith. There was never an agreement that I was aware of.
Thank you. So you never regarded as viable, as a firm deal, as a real agreement, the proposal rooted through Mr. DeGaran to wait until Koresh had issued his analysis of the seven seals. You never really thought that that was an agreement so that you should stop everything and wait, did you?
No, sir.
Playing my time so that I can yield to Ms. Lee.
Right. I just had one final. Well, that's good enough. Thank you, Mr. Wise. Thank you, Ms. Jackson Lee.
Thank you very much, Mr. Schumer.
And thank you very much, Mr. Wise.
Mr. Nossinger, I wanted to ask you, did you fail to take into consideration David Koresh's religious beliefs? Was that something that was very much a part of this ongoing negotiations? And I just need maybe a yes or no in a sentence. My time is limited as well.
We did take it into consideration.
And were you working with him then on what he was attempting to get done in order to get his word out?
Yes, indeed.
I'm going to read. There was some discussion about frustration. These are not transcripts that I believe are done by the Justice Department. I believe these are summaries of transcripts given to us by witnesses yesterday. It reads a transcript of the last recorded words of David Koresh, but it does provide an interesting point because I think these individuals, the theologians, certainly had concern about David Koresh. It has the FBI saying, I'm not frustrated. I went home and I'm back. I'm no longer frustrated. I was never frustrated. Was that the sense of the negotiations? Were you continuing to try and do as much as you could, Mr. Sage, to ensure that these people came out?
Absolutely. Up to and including the 19th.
Well, I think that as we looked at my earlier questions, I wanted to come back again to the point of whether or not we were going all the way to the end and trying to make sure that these people came out safely. Mr. Jamar, I'd asked you about the architectural structure and whether you knew about it. I don't think you ever got to answer that question. And what was the preparation in order for them to be able to come out? What waves were you looking as the CS gas was going in? What were the exits that were clearly there for them to be able to come out?
You walk up there.
I would appreciate it. Thank you.
Initial gas was going to be here, in this corner. It was there.
If you could speak loud, I'd appreciate it.
I'm sorry. The initial gas was right here. The thought was we would contaminate this part of the building at the lower level. And it would be clear to the occupants what's coming next. That was all it was going to be. And the thought would be that they would move here. The hope was the realization that we're not going to stop the gas is going to ultimately make the whole place temporarily uninhabitable, that was going to come. We thought it would be some people would still come out even with just one insertion. There was this door, there were doors in the back.
And they were not obstructed or they were not nailed shut as far as you know?
As far as we knew at the time. Later on we discovered that this door was, there was no people coming out after we put a lot of gas in there. The gas was not that effective, which I think we're going to get in more detail later in the hearings, but we thought people should be coming out. So we said, let's see if that door is blocked. So we discovered that it was. We pushed up, and so we made.
And your pushing was what, manual or by the?
No, it was by with a CEV.
All right.
A bladed.
I understand.
Vehicle. Discovered that was not, that was barricaded. So we put another hole right here.
And was the whole intention to cause an explosion, or was it to see if people would come out?
No, it was to make an exit for them. We discovered this was blockaded. There was no other door in the front except come out the windows, which a couple of people did come out the window. But we made a hole here.
So the holes were specifically to be able to let anyone who was finding an obstruction or could not find their way, here is a big hole for you to come out of.
Yes. We did that later over here inside this little courtyard. And we did it over here, right in here.
By the visuals on television, would you say it was a coincidence that as some of that ramming was occurring, the fire sprung up, which gave the impression that that might have caused the fire?
Well, I think that from television, I think most people tell me they saw this smoke here first. And I think about 7 or 8 minutes previous, there had been the approach from here, and the tank had pulled away. Now,
from the observation I was able to make after from air, there was a huge fire behind this tower right here in the kitchen area. There was another fire here. It was very easily discernible from the air. Okay, now, the wiretap, the microphone, prior to 12 o'clock, right at 12, right in that area, not 12:15, the transcript I saw did not have a precise time, but it was after 11:40. Let's not let the fire go out. The fire is already going prior, I think, to this. We hadn't seen it yet. Makes me think it was there probably because I think the microphone was right in here somewhere. I think that's the fire we're talking about. We saw
seeing
this one.
Seeing it shoot up.
No, I think this is what you saw on TV.
Right.
I didn't see this one for a long time. But I believe from that over here, between 11:40 and whenever that tank entered right here later, that's when the microphone went out.
Well, Ms. Jackson, your time has expired. Mr. Jamar will be back for two more panels doing exactly this type of discussion.
I thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. I wanted to emphasize the escape route. I thank you very much for giving me the time. Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Wise.
You're welcome. Chairman, can I make one comment in furtherance of the topic of today's panel negotiation?
Well, you may, Mr. Sage, but Mr. Zelf has time,
okay,
too.
Okay, my apologies.
Do you want to do it at the end, or?
That's fine.
It has nothing to do with Ms. Jackson Lee's question, I assume.
It does somewhat because of the...
May he answer that then, Mr. Chairman?
Yes, that's what I was getting around to, Ms. Jackson Lee, to find out if there's a connection. Rather wait to the end. Go ahead.
Well, there is a connection in that when we began to, with the insertion plan of the CS gas, one thing that this panel please needs to remember is that did not mark the end of negotiations. It was our intent, and I was instructed to go out there prepared to continue negotiations from forward to facilitate the safe and orderly exit of those people for up to 48 hours. It did not herald the end of negotiations. We were hoping that it would prompt the end of the standoff.
Mr. Zelloff, you're recognized for 5 minutes.
Chairman, you know, we have a great deal of respect for all of you and the testimony you've given today. And we had equal amount of respect for Mr. Zimmerman and Mr. DeGaren yesterday. They spent 6 hours in very credible testimony, and I'm really torn in trying to listen to them and then to you in terms of this negotiation offer. And I just want to understand exactly, you know, you're apparently had a two-hour conversation with Webster Hubbell on April 15th. And for the record, did you or did you not tell him, even in a general way, as part of that two-hour conversation, was there a surrender offer on the table that had been discussed with Koresh's lawyers, the Texas Rangers, which they, in their testimony, admitted to last night, and of which Mr. Jamar was aware?
I will state again that there is much more importance placed on this evolution than was in fact there on the 15th of April.
You didn't mention it at all?
Well, let me finish. It was not an agreement. I do not specifically remember highlighting it because there was no credibility to it at that time. We were hoping there would be, but it had not come to pass.
The Texas Rangers felt that there was an agreement of sorts. They were aware of that. It's in my judgment, it's very hard for us to listen to what we heard last night and then with a seriousness of what we're going forward with on April 19th on a plan that, and I guess what I'm trying to figure out, did anybody have an open mind or was the gas plan going to be the deal?
The open mind is exhibited by the fact that we probed this issue extensively from the 14th until up to and including the evening of the 18th, specifically attempting to determine whether or not there had been any demonstrated progress in the area of this alleged manuscript. There had been none, according to us, according to Steve Schneider. There had been none.
What was Mr. Hubbell's reaction?
To what, sir?
Did he ask you if there were any last-minute plans discussed in terms of any surrender?
My recollection of the discussion with Mr. Hubbell was that the overall dynamics from the perspective of a negotiator that had been there in the trenches for the entire period of time, nearly 50 days. I don't I'm not attempting to be evasive here at all. I'm trying to be as candid as I possibly can. The reason I can't definitively state it is because it was not the issue that you're portraying it to be.
Well, I'm just trying to think. We're talking about a plan, and also in the book here on page 271, Justice Department, April 16th, Mark Richard, Assistant AG, met with Hubble and Carl Stern, Director of the Office of Public Affairs. According to Richard, Hubble advised him the Attorney General had disapproved the plan to end the FBI standoff. Hubble then asked Richard what he thought of the FBI's reaction might be. Richard answered that the FBI would not be pleased. I mean, I'm just trying to go through all these conflicts and try to come up with some reasonable base. I guess we never probably won't know.
Mr. Zella, can I add to that?
Yes.
I think I haven't said this very well today at all. We're going from a discussion of a surrender plan and an agreement from the previous early April to come out after Passover. We heard in the overhears he was going to change the date of Passover. It didn't occur. Mr. DeGaron had put his best professional ability and his heart and soul into it, and it just didn't happen. He was, of course, refused. Okay, he didn't give up. He stayed after it, and he came up with this one. It's like a lawyer came up with a case. This is the case that's going to do it. And what he had here was a judge that wasn't going to permit that case to be considered. But it didn't stop him from doing it. It didn't stop us from listening. But for them to imply that there was an agreement with us, okay, we will hold off and not do anything until this is resolved in 10 or 12 days, is just not the case. That was never even close. I valued my relationship very much with Mr. DeGaron. And it bothered me for him to say, and he had said it, and I'd read it in the newspaper, that I had lied to him that day. It's not the case. Okay. He took, may I finish? What he did was, he's a person used to being successful. He doesn't run into failure that much. And he wanted to make sure, and I think he, just like Corus was saying, I think he maybe wanted more out of what I said. Plus, and then it followed very soon thereafter, which made him even more upset. I'm certain of that.
If I can, let me just go through one other then. And again, I'm just trying to figure this all out so that if somebody asks me at a town meeting, I can explain it to them and it makes sense and they'll accept it. And I think that's what all of us really are trying to do. How
Absolutely.
Can we explain it to the American people? There's a visual image that I have, and I don't know whether it was CNN or whatever, that I saw the tanks going in. And I also heard the recording, this is not an assault. But the tanks were penetrating that building. And if I were inside, I would figure it's probably an assault. Maybe I don't, and I'll give you a chance both to answer.
Yeah.
Mr. Zell, but the problem, let me just finish because I'm going to run out of time. Then you guys can take as much time. That's the way we've got it worked out here. I want to just show that on Ruby Ridge, and I'll introduce, if the clerk will pass a copy of this, on the Marshal Service Crisis Center log, there was a little footnote in there, and it's noted as 567, Crisis Center log, August 22nd, 1992, entering at 4:50 p.m. The log also stated that weather was a major factor. And by the way, somebody said there was no new information. The winds were 30 to 35 miles an hour at Waco, I believe, on the 19th. And I'll let you address that, too. But late that afternoon, but might be passed back because of weather conditions. Concern was raised about the deployment of gas into the residents because of high degree of risk to small children and the possibility that a one-year-old baby was inside. And I guess I'm just trying to figure out, as we move forward with the plan on April 19th, this is just a quick question. Did you, in the early morning hours of the 19th or the late hours of the 18th, ever tell women and children inside the compound that negotiations have come to an end and that this is their last chance to come out before the gas was inserted?
No.
And the biggest question is, why did we use the gas when we knew in Ruby Ridge that it was wrong? Why would we use it at Waco? And I'll let both of you respond.
The decision to use CS gas was based on the information received and research received. We went on the fact, on the decision was made based on CS gas as not to be c- could be possibly effective to them, but not to be permanently damaging or deadly. We went on that premise. It was not a cavalier attitude towards children by any stretch of the imagination. We were confident from the information we had that this gas is the tear gas is the best. If we're going to have to use tear gas, it's the least toxic, caustic, whatever, however you want to say it. That it's not toxic at all. But we did not think that children would be permanently damaged and or otherwise harmed by that gas. If we'd have thought that, I promise you, Mr. Zeloff, we wouldn't have done that. If I believed that, I wouldn't have done it.
Can I answer that? First of all, before I address that issue, you mentioned earlier that the Texas, something about the Texas Rangers thinking that he was prepared to come out.
Excuse me, I don't want to leave a false impression. My understanding of the conversation yesterday is a matter of record that they were aware of a plan that Mr. DeGaren had worked out with the Branch Davidians.
Okay, by this time, they were an integral part of our negotiation team. The Rangers were part of the negotiation team from approximately mid-March. They should have been earlier on. That's one of the mistakes. My feeling is that I should have brought them into it or made a recommendation to bring them into it considerably earlier. But they were part of the analysis. They were part of the negotiation team at that time, and they certainly agreed with the, at least my recollection is that they agreed fully with it. So they were of a common mind with us, with the rest of the combined joint agency negotiation team, that Koresh had no intention of coming out. They agreed with that fully. You had mentioned that, or you had asked whether or not we had told them that negotiations were over and that tear gas was to be inserted. Negotiations were not over. We stood ready to continue to facilitate those negotiations. The call was put in there at 5:59 approximately the morning of the 19th of April. Steve Schneider listened to the initial portion of my discourse to him, whereupon he hung up and shortly thereafter threw the window out, or the phone out the window. A little difficult to negotiate with the phone out the window. We still stood ready to reinitiate that if, in fact, they would indicate that the reestablishing of that phone was to facilitate the safe and orderly release or exit of everyone in that compound. We stood ready to do that, sir, up until the flames ended.
I guess the only question I had, and the only reason I ask it again with the red light on, is did we at any time give them formal notice that it was over, even if it was 2 seconds before you put the gas in, before the gas was inserted in the building?
Yes, sir.
We gave them notice that they have 2 seconds to come out before we start?
No, we gave them notice before the first CEV had made it anywhere near the compound to begin the gassing operation. They were notified both over the phone and simultaneously over the loudspeaker system because I did it. I had the phone to my ear and the microphone to my chest.
I guess the problem that I have, and I won't have it figured out yet, is if the stuff at Ruby Ridge, if CS gas was bad there, why wasn't it bad at Waco? And I'll have to sort that out as we go through the rest of the testimony. Unless you want to add anything to it.
Well, I think there's going to be a full-length panel discussion tomorrow about that, isn't it?
Thank you very much, Mr. Zeloff. I yield myself the 5 minutes. I don't believe there's anybody else who has time left on this. And then we'll conclude the panel. First of all, I want to, though I will thank you formally when you do get recessed, thank all of you for the time today. Several of you will not be back, although Mr. Jamar, I believe maybe Mr. Sage will be back. I know you're going to be back with us 3 times altogether. I do want to make the comment that I find almost everything today you said to be right down the line what I expect from my FBI. I think you've explained this very, very adequately for most people's consideration. The only really disturbing thing that remains here today, and you should be aware of it by the tone of all the questions, is the sense that I think several of us get up here that you didn't take seriously, and maybe you shouldn't have. I'm not saying you should have, but that you didn't take very seriously the ideas that Mr. DeGaren was presenting on the 14th of April, that there was really something new here. And what Dr. Tabor and Dr. Arnold said to us last night, that they felt that this was a real breakthrough with Koresh, and that indeed he was looking at things differently on the 14th in terms of his prophecies, and he really didn't intend to commit suicide, if you will, or be a martyr or kill people or have people die at that point, that he had completely changed. And I can understand why you might not buy into that. But it appears that because you didn't, that even if it were conveyed back up there, that neither you, Mr. Sage, nor you, Mr. Jamar, personally thought enough of it to make a big point of it, at least a point well enough emphasized to potentially get the full flavor of that back through the chain to the Attorney General. And I think from today's testimony, it's pretty clear that you two didn't do that. Now, I'm not faulting you for not doing it necessarily, but it is a point that I think is worthy of our being concerned, simply because that is the point that those who are most concerned about this incident have raised with regard to the negotiating part. That is what they have criticized most directly, and I think we now have a pretty good grip on why. Now, with that in mind, I have just two quick questions not related to that. Mr. Nussner, I want to ask you something. Whether it's from Mr. Revis's book or whether it was some testimony that I've heard in the last few days, and gosh, we've heard a lot of stuff, I'm not sure where, but it's my impression that there were tapes that were shown back inside the compound during the siege that were made of the children that did come out, or some of the children, and in order to demonstrate they were okay. And that in part, one of the critics has said that this upset the folks inside, not because the kids were ill or anything, but they were shown eating candy bars and doing things which would not have been permitted inside the compound, and that this was extraordinarily upsetting and could potentially have had some effect inside negatively on all the negotiations. Could you comment on that? Is that accurate? Did those tapes go back in? Was that, in retrospect, somewhat of an error?
No, it wasn't an error whatsoever. In fact, it was a very innovative strategy, and I think we might have got one complaint from one mother who was already had demonstrated a great deal of anger at us and was mad because her child was eating ice cream, something which she never allowed. Other than that, we think they were extremely positive. The intent of sending the tapes in there was to demonstrate to the parents that their kids were being well cared for. But more than that, when the kids would come out, they would have little notes saying that my child is to be sent to a relative or a friend to be raised. As negotiators, we were concerned that this was, in essence, the parents taking care of the final responsibility of their children, settling their affairs, and now being willing to set the stage for their suicide. What we conveyed to the parents is that, no, the children are not being sent off to Aunt Sophie in Des Moines, that, in fact, they're staying right here with the Child Protective Services, and we're waiting for you to come out and resume your parental responsibilities. And we also think those tapes had a very powerful impact on doing what we intended, and that was tugging at the heartstrings of these mothers to try to rekindle their maternal and fatherly responsibilities, to break them from the hypnotic sway of David Koresh. We also sent a very innovative tape in. David Koresh sent his first, we sent tapes of the kids in. He sent a tape out on March 8th. We did something that, to my knowledge, never done anywhere. We sent in a tape of the negotiators. And I and four or five other negotiators who had talked with him at that time, each of us were videotaped showing photographs of our families and personalizing the negotiation, saying, Mr. Koresh, David, my name's Gary. I'm one of the ones who've been talking to you. And this is my family, and I love my family, and I know how you love your family. And I want you and everyone in there to know that we're doing everything within our power out here to make sure that you and everyone inside and your children are going to come out here safely and are going to be treated with dignity and respect. I think those tapes accomplished a great deal. In fact, when Kathy Schroeder watched the tapes, she was so moved that her child, Byron, needed her, that John Dolan, now retired FBI negotiator, was absolutely brilliant in convincing her that little Brian needed more than anything else right now, a hug from his mommy. And she immediately, without consulting with David Koresh, said, I'm coming out tomorrow, and she did.
Well, I think that point is well made. Mr. Sage, I want to ask you, and then perhaps have Mr. Nussner, Mr. Smerick, or anyone else comment on this as you want, about the mass suicide commitment. I'm confused a little bit, and I'd like you to express this to me. In the report, the Justice Department report, it appears that near the end of all of this, the 15th, 16th, 17th, when they're discussing this back in Washington, they've reached the conclusion, based on representations from you, that it is your impression that suicide is not likely. It's possible, but now at this point, you didn't think it was likely. However, we've heard testimony today. I think, Mr. Jamar, you made it, and I'm going to turn to Mr. Sage first, but I'm more than happy to have you comment on it. that at some point afterwards, whether that's because of the fire tapes, I'm not sure what, you need to clarify it for us, that you concluded that there was a suicide pact. At least I'm thinking that's what you said. If not, we need to clarify it. However, at the time, you did not think so. I'm of the impression that the tapes that were made of the last few days of the discussions that went on and the negotiations and so on, or the perhaps the eavesdropping tapes, that those together, what was presented to us in part last night by Drs. Arnold and Tabor, would demonstrate that the folks inside weren't leading up to the 7th, the 19th, at all in a suicide attitude, that perhaps since the 2nd or so of March, they were for the first time in those last few days openly optimistic, talking about coming out, being an attitude that was just much more upbeat in the last 2 or 3 days of this, or last 4 or 5 days. They attribute, that is Arnold and Tabor, and I believe DeGaron, this attitude shift that's shown in these tapes that they say they've reviewed, that of course are in existence, and I'm sure you've reviewed, and you of course were hearing it at the time, to the change in Koresh's viewpoint of the world and the basic interpretation of the seals and so on. I don't want to get too much into that, but that's what they attribute it to. But nonetheless, whatever the reason may be, they say those tapes would demonstrate, and the conversations and the attitudes of the people, all the people in the compound, that suicide was the furthest thought from their mind prior to the entry of the gas and the notice of that in the early morning hours of the 19th for the previous several days. Which is it? Now we look back. I'm just asking this. How do you reconcile this? Was your first impression right? And that would, of course, been consistent with the tapes, their interpretation of the tapes, Tabor's, Arnold's, and DeGaron's, that the folks inside were not contemplating suicide up through this point, or was it that they had a suicide pact and they were ready to release it? Or is there a way to reconcile these two? And knowing what you know about Koresh and the people inside the compound, all these negotiations, and before we dismiss this panel today, and negotiators part of this, I'd like to know.
I would too. Throughout the course of this 51-day period of negotiations, as I mentioned before, we address this issue head on, which is a recommended approach. Do you intend to commit suicide? I have several examples where he steadfastly denied any intention, nor did he embrace the concept of a mass suicide. The bottom line on this, sir, in my estimation, is that this man was an absolute master of deceit. He also exercised absolute control over his followers. He may well write a new chapter in the behavioral science books and so forth. We took him at his word, not just from these quotes, but from some of the subtle responses that we elicited from him that were, and from others in there, that were survival-oriented. We now know, with the luxury of hindsight, which we did not have then, but we all now have today, from testimony of some of the surviving Branch Davidians, that yes, they did have a suicide pact, and it's very clear that they did, in fact, at the direction or at the hands of David Koresh, consume the lives of over 78 Branch Davidians on the 19th.
Mr. Jamar or Mr. Nessner?
Nessner, let me comment. You also will frequently see some ambivalence with suicide. And that is some uncertainty and doubt. There are those who suggest, and I don't necessarily agree with those who say David Koresh was planning every moment, knew exactly what he was going to do, and had a specific end in mind. I don't necessarily buy that. I believe David Koresh was stalling and playing day for day. He'd certainly prepared his followers for suicide. That was part of his theology. And I think based upon the events as they unfolded and how he interpreted them impacting on him, that was the determining factor as to whether or not any suicidal act would follow. And I think ultimately on that final day for David to give up his kingdom and all his special privileges to go to jail was more than he could do. It's just, he even mentioned at one point in time, we have it a tape, He said, I don't want to become Bubba's love toy in prison.
But again, I don't want to elaborate because my time's expired. I want you to answer. But Tabor, Arnold, and DeGuerin would interpret it as meaning that he decided on suicide if he did, or the group did, after the gas was being inserted, or at the time it was, or in preparation for it when they knew about it, that their attitude was different in the preceding 5 days. And none of you have addressed that, whether you think that the tapes show that their attitude was inconsistent with suicide for those preceding days, and whether the hypothesis that's been put forward by Arnold, Tabor, and DeGuerin could be debunked or not.
Well, I'm not sure if I fully understand, but I do think that the insertion of the gas certainly triggered in David Koresh's mind that he was going to begin this suicidal plan. There's no question. If the question is, did the insertion of the gas trigger David Koresh's implementing his ideas about suicide, I think, yes, he did.
Anyone else want to comment? I don't want to belabor this.
I just wanted to follow a negotiator with a negotiator there. The analysis we did was, how serious is the suicide packed in there from March 1st on? Well, we didn't hear anything specific until Victorine Hollingsworth came out on March 21st. Okay, her statement was corroborated by Marjorie Thomas, who was one of the survivors of the fire, and by Kathy Schroeder, who came out on her, they were expelled, I think, by Koresh. That was in our minds, but the analysis, if we do this, are we just going to have a mass suicide? Okay. And our thinking was that if there is a plan for mass suicide that we don't think there was at the time, and it starts, how are we going to stop it? Only way we can stop it is to insert CS gas. But we were hopeful that when we did this, that it would drive the people out and make the place uninhabitable. We were extremely hopeful there was no suicide plan. Were we certain of it? Absolutely not. I think, but the analysis and the recommendations that most people, analysis recommend that there was not, based on all this conversation for all these weeks. I think that when you, the reading of something, if you really believe something, you're going to read it into it anyway. I think what I will do is I'll reread those with what you just described to me. I'll give that as open mind as I can give. I'll reread those.
The tapes, you mean?
The tapes, with that in mind. But I didn't say it was bogus. I didn't mean to reject that plan. All I said was, give us something this weekend that'll show that you're serious. But they didn't. All they gave us was the stall language. I haven't seen the first tape. I haven't seen the first page. I'm going to edit it. You're not going to get it till I edit it. I haven't seen the first page. We get that on Sunday. That's what we were getting. I wasn't getting any of this, hopeful description of we have a new light and everything's wonderful in here. I never get that at all, but I will reread those, both the overhears and the negotiation transcripts. I'll reread with that in mind, with nothing else in mind. I'll read that.
Well, you'll be back with us, and I appreciate it if you would do it. It'd be very helpful to us. I want to thank this panel for spending much of the day with us today. It's been a very extraordinary day and a very important day. We will resume with two or three of you in the future, but that's it for now. We're going to have the second panel be commenced after you've had a chance to get up, and the other folks can come in.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you.
Yes, sir. Thank you, Mr. Yes. Yes. Let's place it off.
If we could, we're not really in recess. We need to have as much expedition as we can here. We've got several people who are coming in as witnesses. I'd like to start introducing them, if we can get the first panel cleared out. I know that's not quickly and easily done sometimes, but we're running long hours in this subcommittee. Our second panel today, I will begin the introduction of, and please have seats. There are name plates up here for your position, and I will swear you in, and then we'll talk about the procedure for this panel. Dr. Alan Stone has been the Turoff Glick Professor of Law and Psychiatry at Harvard University since 1982. Dr. Stone has been board certified in psychiatry for almost 30 years. He is a past president of the American Psychiatric Society. As a professor at Harvard, he holds appointments on both the faculties of the law school and the medical school at Harvard. Dr. William Marcus, our second witness on this panel, is senior science advisor at the Office of Science and Technology of the Environmental Protection Agency. He is board certified in toxicology by the American Board of Toxicologists. He is also the associate editor of the Journal of Environmental Pathology, Toxicology, and Oncology. Dr. Paul Rice, our third panelist today, is a medical doctor and pathologist. Since 1987, he has served as head of pathology and general toxicology for the Chemical Defense Establishment in Portendown, Salisbury, England. Our next panelist is Dr. David Upshaw, who holds a PhD in toxicology and is a registered toxicologist in England. As a manager of a section of the Chemical and Biological Defense Establishment in Portendown, Salisbury, England, he is involved in research on inhalation and cellular toxicology research. Our next panelist is Dr. George Ulig. He is professor of chemistry and mathematics at the College of Eastern Utah. He also is vice president for research and development at Thermic Laboratories in New York City. Dr. Ulig is a 23-year veteran of the Air Force, retiring with the rank of lieutenant colonel. And our last member on this panel today is Mr. Hayes Parks, a special assistant to the Judge Advocate General of the Army. He is an expert in international law relating to military operations and has served as a member of the United States delegations for law of war negotiations on many occasions. He has taught at the Army, Air Force, and Naval War Colleges and is an adjunct professor at George Washington University. Mr. Parks served in Vietnam as an infantry company commander and later as a judge advocate. He retired from the United States Marine Corps with the rank of colonel. Now, if you'd ask all of you to please rise, I will swear you in. Raise your right hand. Do you swear or affirm that the testimony you're about to give today should be the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth? Please be seated. Let the record reflect that all of the witnesses answered in the affirmative. Today's second panel will be a little different in that four of the witnesses, by pre-agreement, will give 10-minute testimony each. I'm going to introduce you in a certain order for this so you can prepare yourselves for that as I describe the rest of the procedure. Dr. Ulig will be first, Dr. Upshaw will be second, Dr. Marcus will be third, and Dr. Rice will be fourth, to try to just give us a flavor and balance it to our best estimate of how this should be proceeding. So Dr. Ulig, Dr. Upshaw, Dr. Marcus, and Dr. Rice in that order. Now, the way this is going to work, since you've got 10 minutes, I'm going to turn the timer on when each of you begins. The timer is scheduled to run for 5 minutes, not 10. So you'll see it come on, a yellow light will go off. You'll have then another 5 minutes, and it'll run down to a second yellow light. And we really do have to keep with this, just as we do up here with our questioners, or we won't get through this. This will take us a while to do, but the better part of probably of the next 45 minutes or so. But we need to try to keep on this as much as possible. But I think it's important for the CS gas questions that you're going to be discussing for us to give you a chance to explain this to us, since there's a lot of technical stuff here, rather than just starting out with a question session. So with that in mind, if we could begin with you, Dr. Ulig, I will turn the timer on if you're ready to proceed. And you're recognized for 10 minutes. Dr. Ulig.
Mr. Chairman, thank you so much for the opportunity to come here. Let me start out with a very positive side. I've heard a lot of negative today. It's been about 15 years since I've had a good helping of collard greens, and you serve some real good ones downstairs in the restaurant. But let's go ahead and press on CS. I'm a chemist. I'm not an expert in CS. The first time that I experienced what the effects of CS were was when my research assistant, Anita Dingman, and I made a videotape that I've got here of the combustion of CS methylene chloride on cardboard. Worked very well, I should say, and that video is there. I'm not going to try and bamboozle you with a lot of fancy equations. We're going to make reference to amounts of CS agent. Being an educator, I like to use little tiny saccharin tablets so that you get a feeling for the size and weights of CS based on quarters. We all know about what the heft of a quarter is. Now, CS is an abbreviation that many of us would use for brevity's sake. As a chemist, it stands for alpha-chloro-benzylidine malononitrile. That's a mouthful and a half, especially at this time in this hearing. It really takes its name from the two scientists that discovered it, Corson and Stoughton. They prepared it in 1928. It's been the standard riot control agent of the Army since about 1959. I was horrified to find it in the possession of my female students in my classes as a self-protection device. 10% CS and methylene chloride, and they carry these little tubes in their purses. The physical state, actually, of CS is a powder, usually a cream-colored powder, not a gas. You disperse it as an aerosol cloud of finely divided particles, by blowers, bursting grenades, ferret rounds, or burning a mixture of the powder and a fuel. The effects of CS are described in Army publications that I was able to get my hands on as impressive. You need about 20 milligrams per cubic meter to affect incapacitation. This little tiny saccharin tablet that you barely can see is 20 milligrams, actually about that. Some of them weigh 18 milligrams, some of them 20. So that's about the size in a cubic meter. Now, a cubic meter is about the volume of your standard 36-inch diagonal TV set, okay? Now, if I were to go, that contains about 35 cubic feet of air. If I stuck my head in there with one of these little tiny tablets, for 1 minute, I would breathe about 1/64th of this tablet if the Army calculations are correct, and they seem to be to me, and that would incapacitate me. What does it mean to be incapacitated by CS? Now, understand this is for the usual dosage. The affected persons experience severe burning sensations in the eyes with copious tears. My research assistant, Danita Dingman, experienced this in making this video. The eyes close involuntarily. The nose runs and moist skin stings. Amnesty International produced a report towards the end of the 1980s. They were concerned about the excessive use of CS by the Israeli Defense Forces, or the IDF, in the occupied territories. Their findings about what it meant to be incapacitated in excess of amounts of CS, intense tearing of the eyes, shortness of breath, irritation of the respiratory tract, similar to an acute asthma attack, chemical burns, intense nausea, retching, abdominal cramps, and particularly in children, severe and protracted diarrhea. That's a quote from their report. I tried to get some feeling for the amount of CS used at Waco. Very difficult to get your hands on accurate data. But nonetheless, it appears that about 400 of these ferret rounds were used, or in excess of them. There are some sources that indicate a flight right round was used. Some folks would go as high as, as much as 500 pounds of CSUs. I have a tendency to discount that. I think it was more on the order of around 4.5 to 7.5 pounds. If you're an animal, we understand very well what the toxicology of CS is. If you're a pig, for instance, about 5,600 milligrams, which is the weight of about $2.50 worth of these quarters. And this is injected in the space of a cubic meter over 1 minute. If you're a guinea pig, it's about $1.50, the weight of $1.50 worth of quarters. Now, don't go quoting me that a guinea pig's only worth $1.50. Okay, it's the weight of the quarters. I ran across an article when the British tested halon fire extinguishers on humans. They found that the toxicity levels were considerably lower than that for rats. And I'm going to quote from them. The British have a marvelous way of expressing themselves. This may be because of the greater mental complexity of the human organism and the different body chemistry, or maybe simply the rats were feeling rather odd, but nobody knew. Now, the best I've been able to do making a calculation of what it would take to completely kill people in Koresh's size facility would be in excess of 1,000 pounds of agent applied in that facility. I think that that's just totally inconceivable in my mind. I tried to get a better estimate of the amount of CS that could have been injected based on the fireball seen by survivors, and assuming that the dust would carry that fireball through the hallways. I was fortunate in finding a publication from the Fire Institute at Leicester, England, that gave me a range of dust particles. So that if I were to take about a quarter of a sack of this equal right here and dispense it into a cubic foot, then I would have sufficient material, and by the way, equal does burn very nicely, so does sodium bicarbonate, at about those ranges. So does cement powder at about those ranges. Okay? So it could have happened. But when you do that and you cut things down and you look at an orders of magnitude less than that, you reach the conclusion about 75 pounds to 750 pounds, which I still think is excessive. I looked at the logistics of bringing that kind of that amount of material in. A 55-gallon drum, according to manufacturer's literature, contains about 200 pounds of CS. If I'm looking at an agent called CS1, which is a much more persistent agent, this comes 10 8-pound bags packed in a 55-gallon drum. So the logistics of the situation to bring 1,000 pounds on site would be 5 55-gallon drums, 13 55-gallon drums of the CS1 material. Methylene chloride, by the way, in and of itself is a toxic material. I really, the amount injected at Waco that day, probably the lowest estimate, would be sufficient to incapacitate people in about 200,000 square foot Kmart stores, just to give you a feeling for it. It was probably 2 to 4 times the amount that you would need to incapacitate people in David Koresh's complex, just to give you a feeling for that particular number. I think Attorney General Reno, and this is my opinion, may have gotten her wish regarding the children. Gas masks don't fit children very well. They probably, taking a look at some of the data, the bodies and number of children were found in the vault area. These people were probably asphyxiated early on in the game, either by the carbon dioxide injected or by the methylene chloride vapor. And all the methylene chloride would have been a vapor. Calculations using the ideal gas law indicate this. You can take me to task because I didn't do all my sums, but you know, there isn't that much hard data available. In my opinion, the attempt to bring the siege at the Branch Davidian complex to a conclusion was really botched. I think it was Congressman Connors, my time is up, according to my watch, Congressman Connors made the statement that a lot of money was being spent to look at this. In my opinion, perhaps the law enforcement agency should have gone ahead and admitted to making some boneheads and just pressed on and told this committee what they were doing to take care of it. It's a lot like a cat that we have at home we call Snoozer. We play hide and seek with Snoozer. When it's Snoozer's turn to be found, she's got just her head either under the curtains or under the couch. She gets terribly annoyed when we find her. But you know, quarter of her's under the couch, three quarter of her's hanging out. Similar to this type of investigation. My time's up, Mr. Chairman. Thank you.
Dr. Ulig, and I won't dispute your taking the amount of time you did, but for all of you knowing that the green light's still on over here, you would have still had time under my keeping for at least one more minute. But I'm happy that we can save some time because you did that very well, and I appreciate it. I think all chairmen do. Next, I would like to introduce Dr. David Upshaw. Dr. Upshaw, could you give us your thoughts?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Dr. Rice and I are providing a joint statement, so he will not be
Can you turn on your mic
what?
If I don't know
I'm sorry.
It's all right. I'll bring it up closer, one of the two.
My apologies. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Dr. Rice and I are providing a joint statement. Dr. Rice will not give you a separate statement at the end.
Thank you.
I'm Dr. David Upshaw, and I'm accompanied by my colleague, Dr. Paul Rice. I'm a technical manager at the United Kingdom Chemical and Biological Defense Establishment, which is the United Kingdom defense establishment responsible for research upon chemicals in warfare. I've worked at this establishment since 1966. After returning from a postdoctoral fellowship at the University of California in pesticide toxicology. I'm a biochemical and inhalation toxicologist and was closely involved in much of the research which contributed to the UK Himsworth report upon CS, following the first use of this material in Northern Ireland. My colleague, Dr. Rice, is a medically qualified pathologist with experience in both human and veterinary pathology. And during his 10 years at the Chemical and Biological Defense Establishment, he's been responsible for advising the military on the care of chemical warfare casualties, and more recently has been actively involved in advising the British Home Secretary on the use of CS by British police forces. We are here today to provide expert opinion on the use of CS at Waco. Before proceeding further, it might be helpful to you for me to provide you with a brief resume of CS and its properties. As already mentioned, CS is a chemical first discovered in the United States in 1928 and developed for use as a tear gas for the control of civil disturbances in the mid to late 1950s. It's been available commercially and widely used by law enforcement agencies throughout the world for over 30 years. Tear gas is perhaps an inappropriate technical description since it is not a gas, and when used, it is generated either as a smoke or a fog. When used, it may be generated from a pyrotechnic device, that's a burning device, or from a solution in methylene chloride, and it was this formulation that was used in general at Waco. When exposed to CS, human beings experience a burning sensation of the mucous membranes of the eyes, the nose, the throat, and to a lesser extent, the skin, particularly if moist. This produces prolific tearing of the eyes, mucous secretion from the nose, and salivation from the mouth, and there is intense blepharospasm, and what that means is an uncontrollable blinking of the eyelids, similar to that which we all experience when we get a piece of soap in our eyes. The effects produced are in general dependent upon the concentration of CS in the air surrounding the individual, and some useful numbers are that 4 milligrams per cubic meter of air, which is a volume of about 39 inches by 39 inches by 39 inches, will disperse most members of a rioting crowd. And 10 milligrams per cubic meter of air will deter trained troops. However, humans can detect CS in their environment at concentrations about 1,000 times lower than this, a slight prickling of the nose. Now, this is true, of course, for unprotected individuals. Those wearing gas masks would be totally unaffected. Whilst it is the concentration of CS in the air that determines the response, it's important to remember that it is the time for which one is exposed to this concentration that determines the dosage to the individual. You may hear during discussions with this panel the term CT. This is merely the result of multiplying the concentration, the C, by the time, T, in minutes for which one is exposed, and is a measure of the total exposure of the individual. I'll now move to a summary of our assessment and conclusions of the use of CS at the Waco incident. Using the information provided to us by the FBI and available within the report to the Deputy Attorney General on the events at Waco, we've made an assessment of the concentrations of CS achieved inside the building's complex. To do this, we've made a limited number of assumptions. Based upon the knowledge that there were 4 phases of CS insertion, from cylinders mounted on CEV vehicles and supported by ferret rounds. In total, around 380 ferret rounds were used and in general were fired in support of the cylinder insertions. We have assumed that 1/4, that is about 95, of the total number of ferret rounds were fired during each of the CEV insertions. We assumed that all of those ferret rounds entered the building, though in reality we know this was not true. We also assumed a very low rate of air change within the building's complex, about one change per hour, though in reality we know that this also was not true, since most windows have been broken and many large holes have been created in the building walls. The wind speed was also high. I believe it to be up to 28 miles per hour. This higher rate of ventilation within the building would have reduced the concentration of CS below that which we have calculated and would also accelerate the mixing of CS and air inside the building. Despite these assumptions, we calculate that the concentrations of CS within the building did not exceed around 110 milligrams per cubic meter of air at the time of insertion and would decay rapidly after this time. Though it must be accepted that close to the point of release, for a short period of time, it would have been higher than this. Assumed that all of those ferret rounds entered the building, though in reality we know this was not true. We also assumed a very low rate of air change within the building's complex, about one change per hour, though in reality we know that this also was not true, since most windows have been broken and many large holes have been created in the building walls. The wind speed was also high. I believe it to be up to 28 miles per hour. This higher rate of ventilation within the building would have reduced the concentration of CS below that which we have calculated and would also accelerate the mixing of CS and air inside the building. Despite these assumptions, we calculate that the concentrations of CS within the building did not exceed around 110 milligrams per cubic meter of air at the time of insertion and would decay rapidly after this time. Though it must be accepted that close to the point of release, for a short period of time, it would have been higher than this. To put this in context, this would be the concentration a person would experience approximately 60 feet downwind from a riot control grenade when functioned in the open air. Our general conclusions are that the concentrations of CS achieved inside the building were not excessive, that the concentrations would have achieved the desired effect of encouraging the occupants to leave the contaminated spaces, and that even if the occupants chose to remain in the spaces for the entire six-hour period between the start of the operation and the commencement of the fire, they would only have accumulated a dosage of CS that was approximately 10 to 12 times less than that estimated to cause us, to cause serious harm to humans. Finally, I'd like to add that in reviewing this case, both Dr. Rice and I were greatly saddened and moved by the tragic loss of life that we saw, particularly of the children at Waco. However, it's our sincere belief that CS played no direct part in these deaths. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Dr. Upshaw. Do you have anything to add at this point, Mr. Rice? Dr. Rice?
Nothing at all.
All right. Well, you've done it in 5 minutes, so I must commend you as well for that expeditious handling. Now, that doesn't mean, Dr. Marcus, that you have to have a problem with that. You take 10 minutes if you want, but you're next up, and the floor is yours, and you're recognized for what time up to 10 minutes you may consume. You need to turn the mic
Thank
on.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Yeah, it is. Okay, good.
Mr. Chairman, members of the committee, I am very honored to be here to present a talk. I'm a senior science advisor at US EPA. I'm in the office of, the office of drinking water. I usually confine my studies to compounds that may get into drinking water and cause problems in public water supplies. I was asked to look into CS gas, and I did my usual analysis. Because at EPA, I've been there for about 21 years, and my job has been over that time to look at all the information I could gather about a particular chemical, whether it be animal or human data, analyze the data and determine what the effects are on people, try to elicit which particular subgroup is most susceptible, and then based on all these considerations, determine at what level no effect would be found in the most susceptible subgroup. As a government toxicologist, I have no particular axe to grind. I'm not a Republican or a Democrat. I'm just a government employee. There have been some interesting speculations about the flammability of methylene chloride. The Merck Index lists methylene chloride as non-flammable. Now, you can get methylene chloride to burn if the concentration in air exceeds 12%. But when you exceed 12% in air, you have a sufficient amount of material to cause respiratory depression and death. Methylene chloride is toxic on its own. It has the following characteristics of all organic solvents. It causes central nervous depression, causes dizziness at high doses, it causes some nausea, it causes confusion, and it can cause people to become disoriented. CS gas is a very interesting proposition. I was trying to determine, as our distinguished colleague from England, at what concentration would there be a problem in people? And it came to my notice that CS is approximately 3 times heavier than air. The way it works, and I think it was so elegantly explained, is that it's really a very fine powder that forms a suspension in air. In order for it to get into the lungs of people, it has to have a diameter no greater than 8 microns and no smaller than 2. And in the CS1 and CS2 preparation, where the solid CS is ground to what they call a microfine powder, those are precisely the dimensions of the particles. When it's dissolved in methylene chloride, injected in using a ferret round, the material is burst into the air with some heat, methylene chloride leaves it, and you get this fine powder. The problem that I faced in trying to determine the concentration was it tends to fall down, and the closer to the floor you get, the higher the concentration is going to be. And the irony of that struck me is that the children are the shortest, the smallest, and the most susceptible, and they would get the highest concentration. Children are physiologically different than adults. They have a greater surface area in their lung than do adults. Their respiration rate can be 40 times a minute, and adults is about 15 times a minute. The very, very young children, given exactly the same concentration, not the elevated one we know they must have received, would have taken in approximately 8 to 20 times as much material, simply because they breathe faster, they have higher surface area of their lungs, and they absorb it across their lungs at a higher rate. So the problem with children, as I see it, is that not only are they smaller, but given the same exposure as adults, they get a tremendously increased amount. And if we were to use the figures of our colleagues from England, in which he said that there were 10 to 12 times less material available that would cause any harm, that would be sufficient to really make a problem with children, because they would have absorbed at least that much greater amount of material. This is the same sort of analysis that's done when children are going to be exposed to materials from drinking water. And it's an accepted methodology. It's been published in Drinking Water and Health, and it's been approved by the National Academy of Sciences. So we're not talking about some unusual off-the-cuff analysis. So I'm very disturbed at the idea that even with a an analysis that shows that it's 10 to 12 times less for an adult, it's the same for children. It is not. I would like you to keep that in mind. Children are different. Secondly, the skin of children is thinner. The vessels at the skin are much closer. And the material we're talking about attacks that. Now, Doctor, in the beginning, we had an explanation of what the chemical structure of CS gas is. And it's a melanitrile. But actually, since I don't expect any of the members of the committee are chemists and know what a nitrile is, a nitrile is cyanide. And this material has two cyanide radicals on it. When it enters the body can metabolize rather easily one of those radicals and free it as a cyanide. The material that they were exposed to, methylene chloride, produces at normal metabolism carbon monoxide. It doubles, sometimes triples the amount in the blood. The irony of this is that children who have fetal hemoglobin have a greater affinity for the carboxyhemoglobin, and therefore the ability of their blood to carry oxygen is reduced. The fact that cyanide works on every cell in the body, reducing its ability to utilize oxygen, makes the effect worse. And in some of the papers that have been written, that is the mechanism of action. In fact, one Nobel Prize winner, Dr. Hamans, in the 1890s, talked about nitriles as that's the mechanism of action, the production of the cyanide radical at metabolism. I had the honor of working with his son, who also received the Nobel Prize in medicine. So I determined that the most susceptible subgroup was, in fact, the children. Now, I brought with me a respirator. This is not a gas mask. This is what's used by people who spray pesticides or who are exposed to chemicals that shouldn't be breathed in. This is what it looks like. One puts on these two openings a cartridge. And I just brought it along because I wanted the committee to have the opportunity to find out how difficult it is to operate this, and a gas mask is worse. You must push the material out here and you breathe it in through these valves. I'm a very vigorous adult. A child would have a tremendous problem with this, and I invite any member of the committee to just try it and see for themselves what I'm talking about. I'd like to thank the National Library of Medicine's Specialized Information Services Group for providing me with support so that I could get a hold of and present to the committee many of the papers that are available and in the published literature. They were very helpful, and they provide this service to many, many scientists and physicians looking for information. I'd also like to thank the committee for the opportunity of talking about the problems of the exposure of toxic chemicals in children and the problems that were faced by our brave people at Waco. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Dr. Marcus. Without objection, the statements of all of the panelists on this panel will be admitted to the record, as well as the accompanying documentation that you may have with you and the tape, I think, that Dr. Ulig is offering into the record. We are now ready to proceed with the questions of the panel. I will yield first to Mr. Schiff for 5 minutes.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Chairman, just before asking questions, I'd like to make a brief observation, and that is we are now at the point where we are, we've already discussed at great length, and we'll probably discuss again, I assume, the decision of the Federal Bureau of Investigation to try to end the siege. And we've had a great debate over whether they should have waited longer and could have waited longer or not. This is now a more focused issue on once the FBI had made the decision to try to end the siege, whether one agrees with that or not, was the use of CS gas in this plan appropriate or was it dangerous? And therefore, we're focusing on a technical issue. And I just want to say that I've received a great deal of information about CS gas from all different sources. And I have to say, Mr. Chairman, as a former prosecutor, as a member of Congress, I'm accustomed to witnesses having different recollections of memory of fact, and I'm accustomed to witnesses having differences of opinion and judgment. I had this image that the scientific community at least would all be in agreement. We could all at least get past this issue one way or the other very rapidly, and it appears not to be the case as we've seen from the panel here. And so with that in mind, I trust that perhaps when this panel is over, we'll have more of a background as to why there are the differences in the scientific opinion of whether CS gas was appropriate or not. With that, Dr. Ulig, if I may turn to you, sir, you have a military background as well as being a chemist, is that right?
That's correct, sir.
And did your military background involve chemistry also?
It did. In fact, in 1982, I spent about 4.5 months putting together a document regarding chemical warfare agents for the Air Force. For the Air Force Wright Aeronautical Laboratories in Dayton, Ohio.
Let me come right to the point. Dr. Upshaw testified that, in his judgment, there was no toxicity problem with respect to the use of CS gas in the compound. And I believe that you said that you believe some of the people in the compound in the vault were asphyxiated as a result of the use of the gas. Did I understand you correctly?
You did, Congressman. I would submit that the use of carbon dioxide, methylene chloride, these agents would have sunk to the bottom of the building where the vault was used to protect children in particular. And well, these are suffocating agents in and of themselves.
I wonder if you'd expand on that. Are you saying that the CS gas is actually a powder?
It is.
Is that right?
That's correct.
Are you saying that this is a suffocating agent by itself, or are you saying that things produced with it or accompanying it are suffocating?
No, I'm saying the material used to dispense it. In this particular case, it was dissolved in methylene chloride. The methylene chloride is an agent that does suffocate. Not only methylene chloride, but carbon dioxide. And so far in testimony today, I have not heard anyone be concerned about the use of carbon dioxide and methylene chloride. All the methylene chloride would have been a vapor.
All right. Now, the methylene chloride and the carbon dioxide, was that accompanied with the CS gas in both ways it was delivered?
Congressman, as far as I can determine, if you look only at ferret rounds and the Model 5 ISPRA system. Those two were specifically mentioned, and they indeed do use methylene chloride as injection devices. If there was carbon dioxide used, it would have been with the Mark V Fogger unit. That's a U.S. unit.
Maybe we should take a moment and let me ask you, please. How do you understand that the gas was inserted into the compound? How did the FBI go about doing that?
Congressman, I got so many doggone ideas on that in my investigations. The official version that I have is they used a Model 5 Israeli-designed system to inject the CS methylene chloride mixture. Ferret rounds in and of themselves contain 10% CS in methylene chloride. If the calculations are correct, the mixture in the Model 5 ejector bottles.
Could I interrupt you at this point?
Sure.
Is there a difference between Model 5 injector bottles and ferret rounds?
There is.
Would you please explain? And both were
sure.
used in this. Both were used in this situation.
That's
right?
Correct, Congressman.
How are they different? Could you explain that?
A ferret round is about 40 millimeters in diameter, typically 37 to 40 millimeters. You use a launcher. These were fired by Bradley combat vehicles. That's a typical ferret round. The M5 or the Model 5 ejector bottle basically contains roughly 30 grams of CS dissolved in almost 1,100 grams of methylene chloride and 700 grams of a carbon dioxide propellant to expel it.
I have to interrupt because my time has also run out. I believe I will have more time in a little bit.
Okay.
But the bottles were inserted by the tank moving right up and putting the barrel into the building. Is that right?
That's correct, sir.
All right. And I just want to ask to make sure I understood correctly. It's your opinion that the gas or the substances with it may have directly caused the suffocation of people in the compound?
The methylene chloride and the ejectant, carbon dioxide, could have done that, in my opinion.
How certain do you feel that it did?
Oh, dear. With the children, I think there's a good chance. In dealing in probabilities, probably a 60% or 0.6, 0.7.
Thank you very much. My time has expired.
Thank you, Mr. Schiff. Mr. Scott, you're recognized for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Parks, the CS gas is subject to some discussions about treaties. Can you tell us some background of where the CS gas is affected by various treaties on military use and what effect that has on civilian use of CS gas?
Yes, sir. First, I submit a written statement, and I appreciate the comments of the chairman that will be incorporated into the record, so I'll not go through the entire long answer for you. Let me make several critical points here. First, the United States does not consider riot control agents, and I include CS in that, to be a chemical weapon.
Okay,
second,
sorry, could you say that again?
The United States does not consider riot control agents, and I include CS in that, to be a chemical weapon. Second, the 1993 Chemical Weapons Convention does not apply to law enforcement at all. Third, the Chemical Weapons Convention is not yet in force, and fourth, the United States is not a party to it. The riot control agents, as the previous panelists have described, were developed in 1928 as we were developing our chemical weapon deterrent capability. At the time that they were being developed and subsequently, however, there was a concern that the use of a riot control agent on the battlefield might be misperceived by an opponent as use of a lethal chemical weapon, resulting in an escalation in the chemical weapons environment on the battlefield. Hence, restrictions have been placed on their use on the battlefield so that the opposing force would not respond in kind. However, riot control agents...
You mean they might respond...
By a more serious, lethal-type chemical weapon. However, riot control agents, as the previous panelists have indicated, have been widely used in law enforcement, and it was not the intent in any of the treaties related to the use of chemical weapons on the battlefield to restrict the use of CS or other riot control agents in domestic situations.
So in this case, it was not a violation of any treaty, and whatever treaties there may be, the danger of CS gas was not the reason for it being a violation of the treaties that other countries are parties to?
Well, the particular treaty where I think everyone is to which everyone is referred is this 1993 Chemical Weapons Treaty, and it is not yet in force. There would have been no violation of that treaty in the use of CS in a domestic law enforcement situation.
Thank you. I'm not sure who this question ought to be aimed at, but we've focused all of our attention on CS gas. If we were going to use a tear gas, or use that term generically, what other kind of gases would have been considered, and can you state the relative danger of the other alternatives to determine where CS gas would have fallen into that mix? Mr. Upshaw?
Yes, sir. The two commonly used tear gases, they both are aerosols or smokes, are CN, chloroacetophenone, and CS, the smoke we're talking about. CN was used in the First World War and was by and large the tear gas that preceded CS. It is about five times more toxic and has generally been superseded by CS in most police law enforcement agencies throughout the world for that very reason. It's still available, I believe, in some police forces.
Did anybody else want to comment on that? Is it fair to say that of all the gases that could have been selected, CS was the safest, least lethal, and most appropriate?
Unquestionably, yes.
Does anybody disagree with that?
I have to disagree in the sense that I'm not sure you want to select a gas to do that.
But if you were going to select a gas, CS would be the preferred choice.
Well, CS, you have to remember why CS got developed. The British were having a lot of trouble in Cyprus with riots. And the CN that they were using didn't control the riots very well, so they attempted, they used a CN gas. They tried to control the riots with CS, and they managed to do it much more effectively. So it turns out to be a very effective riot control agent, which means it gives a much better response at a lower concentration, and therefore I think the British felt that it was less toxic.
Well, did Mr. Upshaw, you just said that it was not as lethal as CN.
Let's clarify that.
CS
was developed because it was safer. It is more irritant, therefore the margin between the effective dose and the toxic dose is considerably wider than that of CN, and that's why CN has been superseded by CS. The safety margin for that compound is considerably greater.
Thank you. How should it be administered, and what kind of considerations should you take into, what sort of factors should you take into consideration, like the wind and other factors that may have been on site?
It depends on what situation you're considering, but if you're considering rioting crowds in the open air, for example, you would be considering the wind because you would want to know which way the wind was blowing and at what speed it was blowing, obviously, or you might miss the target that you were aiming for. In enclosed areas, you're considering the concentration that you might achieve in that enclosed area, so you have to consider the mass of material that you wish to insert.
Let me ask, and my time is almost up, what kind of, how well can you predict the reaction that people will have if they're subjected to this gas? There was a fairly tense situation, and with the people coming in and shots being fired, and with the kind of person we had in David Koresh, how accurately should we be able to predict the reaction of the people in the compound? Whoever wants to answer, Subshul or Mr. Rice.
I think it's true to say that above a certain concentration in the air, the signs and the symptoms that people, excuse me, develop in response to the exposure above a certain point are not exceeded. In other words, once you get above a certain concentration, the signs and symptoms don't get any more severe. That concentration, we believe from studies that we've done, is around 10 milligrams per cubic meter. That is the concentration, if you remember, that will deter trained military troops. Above that concentration, the symptoms persist, but they don't get any more severe. We can't deny that those symptoms are nasty, they're horrible, they're not very pleasant, but the whole reason for using an agent such as a tear gas is to induce these symptoms. The point being, above a certain concentration, they don't get any more severe in proportion to the increase in the concentration.
Did Mr. Upshaw want to answer the question?
No, I agree with what Dr. Rice has said. We're talking here about the irritation produced.
Thank you very much, Mr. Scott. Your time has expired. Mr. Shavitt, you're recognized for 5 minutes.
Thank you. I'll yield my time to the gentleman from New Mexico, Mr. Schiff.
Thank you, gentlemen, for yielding. Dr. Uhlig, I would like to return to you, please. As I indicated before, I have been told everything from that CS gas is the mildest form of substance that could be used if one is going to use a substance in this situation. to the opposite, that it could have potentially lethal effects, at least with the gases that might be included with it. And I want to come back to you. Gases that might be included with it. And I want to come back to your testimony about asphyxiation. I'm told that, or possibly, a 60% chance of asphyxiation, which is what I believe you said. I'm told that in the studies that have been done on CS gas, that there is no documentation of any lasting injury from the use of that gas, even if its effects could be temporarily unpleasant. Could you respond to that, please?
I'd be pleased to, Congressman. Amnesty International's report indicated that the excessive use of CS in the occupied territories by the Israelis resulted in deaths, both of children and aged people. My colleague here from the United Kingdom has another document before him that I was able to get a hold of as well, that documented some Canadian studies that were made during the Vietnam War that indicated again that there were deaths attributed to CS in very high concentrations, albeit in this particular document that the Canadians have furnished and that my compatriot has here, those particular devices were pyrotechnic dispensers where the heat of a charge dispenses the CS methylene chloride mixture or the CS gas as a powdery charge. I might also add, Congressman, that if we wanted to clean out this room, it would take about the weight of 2 quarters to completely incapacitate us at about 10, 15 milligrams per cubic meter. So it's not much of an agent at all to chase you out.
Mr. Chairman, I'd like to reserve the balance of my time at this time.
I yield then to Mr. Heineman what time I have left. You have left.
All of my time to the gentleman from New Mexico, Mr. Schiff.
I thank the gentleman for yielding. I'm sorry for that, Dr. Ulig. We have certain procedures to follow in the control of time.
That's fine, Congressman.
Back to you, sir. Let me just ask you, did you complete your statement about the reports?
I did, sir.
Let me ask you this question. As you've just heard and as you know, the British government has used CS gas extensively in various situations. Do you have any knowledge of reports from the British use of CS gas that you could refer to?
The only report that I found and had access to was the one that is laying on the table right here from Her Majesty's Stationery Office. And if I could borrow that, please. This is a report of the inquiry into medical and toxicological aspects of CS. And in that particular document, I think you can go through it. It's around page 20 or so. The deaths, they talk about deaths in Vietnam through the use of these agents. Now, the interesting observation out of this document basically is that you'd have to fire 40 to 50 of the pyrotechnic flight right devices into a room, and correct me if I'm wrong, 10 by 10 by 8 roughly, in order to cause death.
Is there a name to this report that you're referring to, if you
yes,
know?
Yes, sir, I just gave it to you.
Would you say it again, please?
Let me borrow. Go ahead.
Or Dr. Upshaw?
If I might add, it's commonly called the Hemsworth Report
right.
In the UK.
Thank you very much. Go ahead, Dr. Ulig, please.
Okay. It said that the use of 40 to 50 projectiles in a room was clearly outside the realm of possibility. And yet at Waco, 400 or so, approximately 400 of a non-pyrotechnic round, but having about the same volume of agent, were fired into that complex. That, to me, would suggest that it was excessive.
Now, are you aware if any autopsies were conducted on the people who died in the compound and whether they confirm asphyxiation, and if they do, is there any way to confirm what the source of asphyxiation was, given the fact that there was a fire and other circumstances there?
I don't know that you can confirm after the fire situation, that you can confirm how much of the deaths or how many of the deaths were attributed, say, to cyanide generated by the decomposition of CS. CS, in my opinion, decomposes to give ethylene. Ethylene, when it's ingested in the body, would more than likely be converted to ethanol. The carbon monoxide concentrations in there, typically in a fire situation, you have large quantities of carbon monoxide generated. It'd be very, very difficult to ascertain how much hydrogen cyanide in the autopsies was due to CS and how much it was just due to normal decomposition of materials within the structure.
A great deal of emphasis has been placed on the fact that there were high, relatively high winds blowing in the area of the compound on the day that the CS gas was used, and I believe stated or at least implied that the windows had been broken out so that there was a lot of air going through the buildings at that time. Wouldn't that have dissipated the gas, whichever gas we're talking about, whether we're talking about the CS powder or the methylene chloride or the carbon dioxide, enough to reduce them certainly to below lethal levels?
That might be the case. I didn't calculate 110 milligrams per cubic meter, Congressman. I calculated more on the order of about 40 to 50 milligrams per cubic meter of CS gas in the facility. And that was a little bit lower than my colleague from the United Kingdom calculated. That was a back of the envelope calculation. I think we're both hunting in here. To me, that's anywhere from 2 to 5 times more CS than you need to incapacitate a person, with the winds.
Do you know what the, so even with the winds, there were, in your judgment, you're saying there's an excessive amount of CS gas?
In my opinion, it would be, as an observer from the outside.
In the vault, which is where you testified to, were the bodies of people who, if they died in this way, most likely did, do you know what the ventilation in the vault was?
My understanding is it was windowless. There wasn't any ventilation in there.
So every room in the compound didn't have a window, as far as you know?
As far as I know, that's correct, Congressman.
Okay. What information did you receive? Did you ever receive any official information in looking at this as to how much gas, CS gas, was actually used?
Congressman, I tried hard to find that, and I ran up against a brick wall, quite frankly. People were very reluctant in the part of the government to give me any information, and I understand that. With many, many people calling in, and I'm sure they would say, gee whiz, who is this fellow from a rural community in Utah who wants to know and get a firm fix on what we've done? And I'm sorry, Congressman, I didn't get that. The information, some of it came secondhand as to how much had been injected.
My time has expired again. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Ms. Jackson Lee, you're recognized for 5 minutes.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman, and thank you, gentlemen. I say this as we proceed with these hearings, that we're really trying to get to the solution and acknowledge the great tragedy that was experienced. And we hope that you gentlemen may be able to cast a lot of light on either what happened or how we can avoid it prospectively. I think one of the points that was made in reference to a study that might give us some pause, Dr. Upshaw and Dr. Rice, for concern would be the Amnesty International study. And I'd like for you to expand on that as it relates to CS gas. Is that a document that we can rely upon? And what do you think of it? Is it reliable as to this particular gas? And I might add, let me be corrected, I noticed that Dr. Upshaw said it was like a smoke or a fog. So in actuality, not so. And I have another question, but I do want you to take the time that you need. It's a very important point for me.
Can I begin
go right
by
ahead.
Answering? We've looked at that Amnesty International report, and it contains testimony to several cases in which people were exposed to tear gas. And that's all the report says, tear gas. It doesn't specify which particular tear gas. The problem that we had with that particular report, particularly when you read on to the end of the report, where it says that the Israelis had access to both CN and CS tear gases.
Say that again, C?
S and CN.
N like in Nancy.
Yes.
All right.
Tear gases. is that those people could have been exposed to either one or both. Now, from what we've already said, we clearly know that CN is far more toxic than CS. That's the first point. Looking at the actual medical documentation of those cases that were exposed, there is reasonable doubt as to what the cause of death of those people were mentioned in that amnesty report. I think it's not beyond reasonable doubt to suggest that a lot of those people died of cardiovascular disease. Okay, maybe induced by the stress of trying to get away from the gas cloud that they were exposed to, but I see nothing in that report whatsoever that links unequivocally the exposure of those people to CS.
Was the study done by chemists and physicians, this Amnesty International? Did they retain scientists to do this analysis, to your knowledge? I'm not sure of their expertise
not,
in that area.
Not to my knowledge, but I mean, I haven't really gone into that report that deeply, whether any analysis was done. The report on first reading to me appears to be a fairly anecdotal one where these cases were accounted in a fairly historical way, and I saw no evidence of any deep scientific investigation of those cases.
And I'll let you answer in a moment, Dr. Stone. Is that Dr. Stone? But let me say, since we are all fairly here looking for solutions, we might then cast great doubt on relying upon that document if we're trying to solve and or prevent a future tragedy in terms of the reliance of what it says about CS.
What's said in that report and what's said in a lot of these reports that account human exposures to tear gases particularly is that it's very difficult from all those reports, and the Amnesty International report is just one of them, what the exposure to the gas is in terms of concentration and time. And those two parameters are essentially very important to be able to gauge whether the exposure has been at a near lethal level to the gas or not. And we don't have that information from the Amnesty International reports.
Let me pursue just a moment with Dr. Upshaw to ask him, in his analysis and in his report, you made the point that, or at least it appeared to me, that individuals would not be immobilized. There might be the tearing that comes from a soap in the eye and certainly some other physical ramifications. I want you in your answer to include the impact on children. I'm now at a point now where there are large gaping holes inside the building. Hopefully debris is not in the way and an opportunity for individuals to escape. However, there is this smoke and this fog. Can they get out? Are they still mobile? I read something here that said they might even be able to do math problems. I'm not sure which document I was reading that, so they might have some certainly mental capacities. But share with me whether or not, if you were seeking to get out, if there was gaping holes and sunlight coming through, could you get out with the gas, smoke, smog around you?
Yes, I share with you the thought that I couldn't do mathematical problems if I was exposed to CS. My main objective would have been to get out of the environment as quickly as possible.
That would be my chief concern.
there is no evidence, documentary evidence, and that is also true within the Himsworth report, that children are more susceptible than adults to the sensation of the irritation to CS. The evidence would suggest that most human beings are equally sensitive, regardless of their age. CS is, in a military context, termed a physical incapacitant as distinct from what I would call a central incapacitant. In other words, it has no effect whatsoever on your cognitive functions. It only has an effect on the sensation of pain. It's a peripheral sensory irritant. It irritates the mucous membranes in that sense. There is a tight blinking of the eyes because of the irritation to the eyes. But in my experience, and I have been exposed to CS many times, the urge to get out of that environment allows you to peek and move, and you know how to get out, certainly. And there's no physical impairment of your ability to leave that environment.
You are independently associated with a facility in England, is that my understanding?
I'm a government employee in the chemical and defense, biological and defense establishment, which is now part of one of the Ministry of Defense's defense research agencies.
You have no actual link to the Department of Justice, or you're not an employee of the Department of Justice?
None whatsoever.
And as I conclude, my understanding, your voice is kind of soft, you're suggesting to me in the answer that I asked for, or the question that I asked, that there was no impairment to the mobility of an adult or a child if there were opportunities to escape. Again, neither one of us being present, but if there was a door open, a window open, or a gaping hole that was going out to an outside area, with that CS inside, people would still, as I understand it, and children, be able to move in the direction of getting out.
Correct.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, Ms. Jackson Lee. Mr. Souter, you're now recognized for 5 minutes.
I wanted to ask Dr. Upshaw and Dr. Rice, have you always been government employees? Have you ever done any work on behalf of the gas manufacturers or any representatives of the gas companies?
No.
None whatsoever.
Okay, thank you. I yield the rest of my time to Mr. Blue.
Thank you very much. I thank my colleague for yielding, and I want to thank all of the panel for their testimony. I'd like to focus my attention now to Dr. Stone and welcome him as a fellow Massachusetts resident. You're a distinguished member of the Harvard University faculty in both psychiatry and law. Is that correct?
Yes.
My thought when I read that was that that combination of disciplines is probably perfect for trying to understand this Waco tragedy. But having said that, I know you also did a report on behalf of the Department of Justice, is that right, on the Waco incident?
Right, right, I did. And I was very critical of the use of CS gas in the presence of children.
I understand. But before we talk about that, you also were critical of the government in general. I want to touch on some of those issues, then move to the CS gas. You wrote in the New York Times that you found the government's investigation seriously deficient. Now, does that mean that you read the Treasury report and you found that deficient?
I found both reports.
Okay. Deficient. I wonder if you could comment where you found them deficient.
Well, let me just... We don't have too much time, so let me just give you the high points. I think one of the critical issues that the committee hasn't gotten to is we had 80 ATF agents come to the compound in cattle cars. We have heard the Branch Davidians described as killers in a deadly ambush. Now, you might ask Mr. Jamar when he comes back, because he told me this, that they could have easily killed all of those agents before they even got out of the cattle cars with the kind of weapons they had.
50 caliber.
Whatever, right? They had enough weapons to kill all those agents, right? Now, that's the first point. The second point is only four agents got killed, and they got killed up on the roof. Right. Now, I want you to think about that. The whole purpose of this raid was to get to the armory, which was supposedly locked on the second floor. Those poor officers are up on the roof going into an armory that is supposedly locked. Well, as soon as they get shot at, they know that, you know, the armory is unlocked. Now, whoever is responsible for this in terms of killing agents or whatever, the sheer stupidity of this is unbelievable. I don't think you have focused adequately on this fact. Here these agents came. As soon as they were shot at, that meant there was no longer a locked armory. Now, the second floor, they also knew, was where the women and children were. Okay? So I think the whole presentation of those issues was not adequate.
So you think the reports missed a lot of the important facts?
In my view, yes.
And approaches that might have been taken. You also go on to say that the government never gave us a candid account of what went wrong. That infers something different. What do you mean by that?
Now, the question in my mind was, after reviewing all this stuff and being briefed by the people in the Justice Department and the ATF, was why was it necessary to carry out the search warrant in this way? I was convinced that they had reasonable cause to serve the search warrant. I only didn't understand why they had to do it with 80 armed men, right? Now, I accept the fact that Koresh was molesting, sexually abusing young girls. But that still doesn't explain why you deal with that situation with 80 armed ATF agent. So I find the ATF has been slippery about that, and I'd like to know, why was it necessary? At times they said that the ATF would say that these people were dangerous to their neighbors. I have never seen any evidence that that is so. Right?
Let me move on, if I could, because we do have limited time, to the question of the gas, because you've also been outspoken on the use of the gas.
Yes.
And in your report, you talk, as others have on this panel, talked about what the gas can do, inflame the eyes, nose, and throat, produce choking. You write that it is difficult to believe that the U.S. government would deliberately plan to expose 25 children, most of them infants and toddlers, to CS gas for 48 hours.
Right.
That statement is very strong. I wonder if you'd elaborate on that.
Well, first of all, toddlers and babies cannot run out of a compound, right, because they can't walk themselves, right? So somebody has to take them.
So if the parents were immobilized by this gas, the children would be totally defenseless to even getting out.
So we have to remember there were lots of babies and toddlers who don't have the ventilatory capacity to use a gas mask. That's the first. Now, the second thing is I took care of babies who have chemical pneumonia. It's an incredibly debilitating illness. Now, although we've had lots of talks about this, we haven't heard how it works in what I'm concerned about. This is an agent which burns mucous membrane, which inflames and irritates mucous membrane. So after a baby breathes it into its lungs, just like a sunburn, right? Hours later, then, the lungs will start to have blisters, just like the sunburn comes on your face. And then the fluid comes into their lungs and they get pulmonary edema. And I spent many nights trying to keep babies alive with just this problem, okay? So, and the research that the British have done, you will see that when they keep their animals in the atmosphere long enough, it's not that they die immediately, it's 8 or 10 hours later when they develop pulmonary edema.
So your final conclusion here, because we're running out of time, is that although it may have been justified to use this gas against adults in a riot or in some other valid law enforcement matter, it is totally inappropriate in any case at any time to use this gas against children.
I think, yes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you very much, sir. We have a dilemma, but we haven't had the second bells yet, but I think that it would be prudent, since we now have a series of votes on the floor they've been holding, for us to take a recess before we conclude this panel with other questions. We will be in recess. The subcommittee will be then until 5 minutes after the conclusion of the final vote on this series. Subcommittees are in recess.
This voice that this guy says about them suffocating from CO2. What drink is that about?
The Joint House Subcommittee hearing on the Waco investigation will continue in just a moment. First, some program information. This weekend, we begin our live coverage of the National Governors Association summer meeting in Burlington, Vermont. Saturday at 11 a.m. Eastern Time, C-SPAN.